sound back down? Okay. Thank you as always, praise team. Glad you're here today. As we mentioned earlier, today is Resurrection Sunday. Amen. A wonderful opportunity for us to celebrate, to gather together, celebrate the love of God so powerfully on display so many years ago. And I want to say, especially if this is your first time with us, and we certainly want to encourage this for everyone, but if this is your first time with us today, I want to encourage you to come back for the next several weeks. I'm starting a series of sermons next week called Are You There, God? And we're going to be taking a look in the Old Testament book of Esther. And if you didn't know this about the Old Testament book of Esther, it never mentions God by name, never talks specifically about what he is doing. Sometimes in life, that's the challenge, right? We know instinctively God is at work around us, but we don't see the doorpost shake. We don't see the burning bush, and so we wonder, is he really at work? And we're going to be looking at how we can recognize God at work when it's not obvious, when he doesn't make himself obvious to us. So I hope you can join us back for the next several weeks. I hope you'll stay with us today after the second service. If you're new here, we have a service after this one. After that one, around 12 o'clock-ish downstairs, we're going to have a potluck lunch. So we hope if you're here, if you come leave and come back at 12 o'clock, we'll have a little Easter egg hunt out back for the little ones, and so we hope you can join us for that as well. Well, this morning we're going to be in Mark's Gospel, chapter 16. So if you've got a Bible with you, turn there to Mark's Gospel, second book of the New Testament, Matthew and then Mark, the very last chapter of the Gospel of Mark. If you don't have a Bible, you didn't bring yours today, there should be one in the shelf there in one of the chairs in front of you. And if you don't have a Bible, feel free to take that with you. That's what they're there for, and so we hope you will take that with you. Mark 16 this morning. And here's one of the things we're going to look at this morning is though throughout the years the arguments have changed, but difficulties with the resurrection have been around since the event itself. The challenges surrounding the resurrection, people, mankind, the heart of man has had a hard time accepting this, and that has been around since the beginning. But we live in a confusing age now, don't we? I mean, no longer are outside sources, science or logic or even the Bible, no longer are outside sources considered our standard or our criteria for truth. Today's day and age, I am the criteria for truth. What I like, what feels comfortable to me, what is helpful or appealing to me, what I accept, that nowadays, right, is the standard of what is truth, the criteria for truth. And there are many who approach the resurrection with that in mind. They say, if you want to believe the resurrection, well, fine, go ahead. That's fine for you if it helps you. But it doesn't really matter to me much. Pastor John Piper said it this way. He said, today, many people view the resurrection sort of like they view UFOs or life on another planet. It might be true, they would say, but what difference does it make in my life? And those really are the two questions I want to answer, or I want to ask this morning. Not are there UFOs and are there life on other planets, not those questions, but the questions, did it happen? Did the resurrection happen? Do we have credible evidence that it happened? It's not a question of my truth or your truth or what is good or appealing to me. There is an objective reality to the resurrection. Do we have an objective argument, criteria, credible witnesses that the resurrection really happened? And then the second question I want to answer is, why does it matter? We sang in that song just a moment ago that for years and years I cared not that my Lord died for me. Does it matter that Christ was raised from the dead? Well, you've got your Bibles open to Mark chapter 16. You follow along the first 8 verses while I read them out loud. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so that they might come and anoint him. Very early on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll the stone away for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone had already been rolled away, although it was extremely large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting at the right, wearing a white robe, and they were amazed. And he said to them, "Do not be amazed. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who has been crucified. He has risen. He is not here. Behold, here is the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you to Galilee, and there you will see him, just as he told you. And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had gripped them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. I want us to see in this short little passage, by the way, all four Gospels record the resurrection, all four Gospels record this event. Mark's Gospel, sort of in keeping with Mark's style, is the shortest, most succinct of them. Mark's Gospel's that way. One word you see throughout the Gospel of Mark is immediately. He's a man of action. He gets right to the point. And I want us to see here in Mark's account, I want us to see three testimonies that we have, credible witnesses that we have, that this account is in fact true. The resurrection really did happen. And then I want us to answer that other critical question, what difference does that make? I think the first testimony we see here in Mark's account, in fact all of them, is the testimony of the empty tomb. The empty tomb, I think, is the most powerful witness to the resurrection, to the reality of the event. Now, why do I say that? I mean, the empty tomb could have meant a lot of things. It could have been that the Jewish leaders, just like they said, it could have been that the disciples stole the body. An empty tomb doesn't necessarily speak to a resurrection, does it? The Jewish leaders came up with this story. The disciples, they're going to take the body. That's the story that they spread. They said that explains the resurrection. Maybe that's what happened. But look again there at verses 1, 2, and 3. Notice there in verse 1 what these ladies are doing. Early Sunday morning, that's the first day of the week. Early Sunday morning, they're coming to the tomb, and notice what they're doing. They're carrying spices with them. Now, that may not mean much to you and me today. That may not mean much to a modern Western mindset. But to a Jewish mind, that meant a great deal. Ancient Jewish culture, and it's this way to today, they don't embalm dead bodies. That's not a Jewish custom. It wasn't then, it still isn't. They don't embalm dead bodies. And especially then, they would put spices on the body, kind of rub it down with spices. They would wrap it in grave cloths. That's how they preserved the body. It was also a method for just counteracting the stink as that body was in the grave. But that was their custom. These ladies are coming to the tomb with spices. That can only mean one thing. They expected a body to be there. There's no other reason they would bring spices. No other reason they would come to do this with spices is other than they expected a body to be there. And then notice again verse 3. As they're walking along, and Mark's gospel is the only one that records this conversation, they turn to each other and they say, who's going to roll that giant stone away? Now, they had been there back in chapter 15, verse 40. They were there watching when Jesus was crucified. They saw that on the hill outside of Jerusalem. They saw Jesus crucified on the cross. They were there, verse 40 of chapter 15 says. Verse 47 of chapter 15 said they saw where the body was laid. As Joseph of Arimathea and his friend Nicodemus, as Joseph took the body down off the cross, and those two men laid him in the tomb. They rolled a giant stone across the front of the tomb. Chapter 15, verse 47 says, these ladies, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, they were standing there. They watched that happen. They knew the tomb that Jesus was in. They knew it had been sealed. As they walked up that morning, they had these spices in their hand, and they wondered, we saw those men roll that stone. Who's going to roll that away for us? That can only mean one thing. They saw the body put in the tomb. They saw the tomb closed up. They expected the body to still be there. Now, what does all that tell us? It tells us that as these ladies, as they walked toward the tomb that morning, the idea of a resurrection had not even crossed their mind. It was the furthest thing from their minds. In fact, in John chapter 20, it says that Mary Magdalene was the first one to see the open tomb. And in John chapter 20, it says she turned and she ran. She ran and she found Peter and she found John. And what she told them was this. They have stolen the body. Not the disciples, some unknown grave robbers. They've stolen the body. The last thing Mary was thinking about was a resurrection. She assumed the body had been stolen. And then down in verse 11 here of Mark 16, when they heard that he was alive, they are the disciples, and he had been seen by her, they refused to believe it. The disciples were not expecting a resurrection. It was the last thing on their mind. They should have been. Jesus told them it was coming, but as they come to this event, they weren't expecting it. We come to that argument that says the Jewish leaders that said, well, gosh, maybe the disciples stole the body. The disciples had no motive to steal the body. The last thing the disciples expected was that grave to be empty. The last thing they expected was a resurrection. Why would they steal the body? They had no motive. And the empty tomb, I mentioned, it's probably the most powerful testimony to the resurrection. It's the one undisputed fact of this account. Nobody throughout history, not then and certainly not since, no one has disputed that the tomb was empty. You know why? Because it was. It was empty. And there was no way to dispute that. That is the one undisputed fact of this. We're told in Matthew's gospel that there were Roman guards that were placed there at the tomb. The Jewish leaders were so afraid that the disciples would steal the body, and they came to Pilate, the governor, and they said, listen, if they come and they steal this body, they're going to go around and claim that he had been raised from the dead. It's ironic, I think, that the Jewish leaders remembered what Jesus said. His own disciples did not. But the Jewish leaders said, if that happens, that'll be worse than it is now. Pilate said, fine, here's some guards. Place them at the tomb, seal it up, make it as secure as you know how. There were two Roman guards standing there. That's significant for us because the guards don't dispute the tomb was empty. You know, they had the most motive. They had the most to gain by disputing whether the tomb was empty or not. They were put there for one reason and one reason only, and that was to make sure that body didn't disappear. And they knew this. They were derelict in their duties. That's how their superiors would look at it. They were derelict in their duties, and if a Roman guard was derelict in his duties, he would have been put to death. They had the most to gain. They could have just rolled that stone right back over and said, done. Disputed that the tomb was empty. They don't. They go back and they report to the Jewish leaders exactly what happened. They don't ever dispute that the tomb was empty. Jewish leaders didn't dispute the tomb was empty. Again, they were concerned. They were afraid that if this tomb comes up empty, man, that's a worse situation than we have with Jesus alive. They would have loved to produce the body of Jesus. Don't listen to those disciples. They're out of their mind. Here's the body of Jesus. There's no resurrection. They would have loved to produce that body. They never dispute that the tomb was empty. In fact, in Matthew chapter 28, they contrived that story that the disciples stole the body. They had to come up with some reason to explain the empty tomb. It is the one undisputed fact of this entire account. And the undisputed fact of the empty tomb is a powerful witness to the resurrection. And the other testimony we have here in this account is the testimony of the angels. Look again there, verse 4. Looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, although it was extremely large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting at the right. Now, Mark's the only one that calls him a young man. John and Luke identify him as an angel. In fact, John and Luke both say there were two angels there. I mentioned Mark is a man of action. He's a man that cuts right to the chase. He identifies one probably because that was the first one that spoke. That's the one that spoke out first, the spokesman of the group. I saw a young man sitting at the right wearing a white robe, and they were amazed. And he said to them, don't be amazed. You're looking for Jesus the Nazarene who has been crucified. He has been risen. He's not here. Behold, here's the place where they laid him. Now, skeptics come to this point, I think, and they say, well, I can't dispute the empty tomb. neither then nor now. I can't dispute that the tomb was empty. The people that were there, the ones that had something to gain, they didn't dispute it was empty. I can't dispute it either. But skeptics would come to this place and they say, well, I just don't know if I can believe something as fantastic as angel testimony. Now, that seems a little too otherworldly for me. Seems a little too out there for me to grab. But I'll tell you, there are some pretty bizarre things that people will believe as messages or testimony, evidence of angels' messages. A couple of years ago, there were those who claimed to see the face of Jesus in a hillside after a mudslide outside of San Francisco. And they looked at that and they said, that's evidence of an angelic visit. Look, the face of Jesus is carved in the side of the mudslide. Others who have claimed to see the image of Jesus in a grilled cheese sandwich. And they said, see, there's evidence of an angelic message to us. And they would come to this event. Some of those are skeptical of the angelic testimony of the resurrection. I'll believe grilled cheeses. I'm sorry, that was a bit. I had to do it. I'll believe the grilled cheese sandwich. But I just can't grab a hold of the resurrection. But the resurrection is not something that the church made up centuries later. It's not something that is just the narrow viewpoint of fundamentalists or the narrow viewpoint of evangelicals. Do you realize what the angelic testimony gives for us? The angelic testimony is the Word of God. When angels came to bring a message, not grilled cheese or faces in mud, when angels came to bring messages, they speak from the throne room of God. The angelic testimony is the very Word of God. How do we know that? Well, here's the evidence of this. Only God could destroy man's best arguments, the best challenges that the heart and mind of man can come up with to challenge the resurrection. Only God could destroy those arguments centuries before they even came around. Verse number 6. The angel says to them, you're looking for Jesus the Nazarene. Now, I think it's ironic that he says it that way. These ladies were close to Jesus. They were very close friends. They had ministered to him. They had traveled with him. Why would the angel identify him so formally? Jesus the Nazarene. Did they have another friend named Jesus they had followed as their master? Did they have another friend named Jesus they were that close with? Did they have another friend named Jesus they had seen crucified that day? Why two close friends would he identify Jesus so formally? Jesus the Nazarene. Several centuries later, there are those who came up. They want to challenge the truth of the resurrection. Again, they can't attack the empty tomb. So they have to come up with an explanation. Why then was the tomb empty? Several centuries later, there was a claim that the reason the tomb was empty, there was no resurrection, but it wasn't Jesus that was crucified in the first place. It was someone else. And by the way, Islam, for example, believes that. It wasn't Jesus that was crucified on that cross. It was someone else. And that's one of the ways that we know the common argument today is, well Islam and their worship of Allah and Christianity, our worship of God, it's the same God by a different name. This is one of the ways we know that's not true. The God of Islam is not the same as the God of Christianity. This is one of the ways we know. Because Islam recognizes Jesus as a prophet. They speak of him as a prophet. But when they founded the religion of Islam, they had to get around the resurrection. Listen, you've got a guy who comes along. He's a prophet, a recognized prophet of God. And he says the sorts of things that Jesus said. I and the Father are one. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Before Abraham was, I am. You have a God that comes and says those kinds of things, a prophet. You have a prophet that comes along and did the kind of things that Jesus did. Gave sight to the blind. Gave the lame the ability to walk again. Even raised the dead. You've got a prophet that comes along and says those things. And then he willingly goes to a cross, takes on the sin of the world from the cross, says, Father, forgive them. And then he's raised from the dead, validating everything he is. You've got a prophet like that. We don't need another religion, right? You don't need to look anywhere else. Why would we look anywhere else? We got this guy here. In order for anyone to get a second glance at this new religion that they founded, they had to get around the resurrection. Here's how they got around it. They said it wasn't Jesus on that cross. Allah, in some even grand deception, made someone look like Jesus. Maybe it was Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. Maybe it was some other criminal. It doesn't matter who it was. It wasn't Jesus. That's what they said. It wasn't him that was crucified on that cross, someone who looked like him. But look again, the testimony of the angel is specific. Jesus the Nazarene, the one, ladies, you knew, your friend, your master, the one you followed, the one who taught you. You ate with him and walked with him and laughed with him and cried with him. You saw him crucified and saw him buried. That same one. Not some imposter, not someone else, not some lookalike, not his brother, not anyone else. That's the one that was here, that you're here looking for. And look at what else he said. He said, you're looking for Jesus the Nazarene who has been crucified. The heart and mind of sinful man has continually, well, that didn't work. Trying to deny it was Jesus crucified on the cross. The heart and mind of man continues to come up with a way. I've got to get around this issue of the resurrection. In the early 1800s, there was an idea that said, okay, here's how we're going to get around it. It was Jesus on the cross. All right, I can't deny that. I can't get around that. But he didn't really die. That's the issue. He didn't really die. That those poor people in the first century, they didn't have all the medical knowledge that we have today. And Jesus, he had been through a tough day. He had been under a lot of stress that day. He had been beaten and he suffered a great deal of trauma that day. Lost a lot of blood that day. He hung on that cross for several hours. He was really dehydrated. What happened on that cross after all of that? He didn't die. He passed out. Very traumatic day. There's no doubt about that. In the cool of the tomb, they said, he came to. The cool air in there, they revived him. And somehow in that state, the beaten, traumatic, blood loss, dehydrated state, Jesus, wrapped in 100 pounds of spices, John's gospel tells us, got up off of that slab. He had the presence of mind to fold his grave clothes. And on nail-scarred feet, he walked to the door of the tomb. With wounded, nail-scarred hands, he rolled away a 4,000-pound stone by himself. Overpowered two armed Roman guards. Now, I got to tell you, if that's the way it happened, if it wasn't a divine resurrection, but that's the way it happened, well, we couldn't say he was the Son of God. We might say he was the son of Jor-El, Superman. We would not say he was the Son of God. But this is not some DC Comics Justice League superhero. The angel says, listen, he was crucified. You saw it. The Romans were experts at several things, and crucifixion was one of them. You saw him die. He was dead when he was put in this tomb. And the angel points to the empty spot where the body had been. Again, the heart and mind of man continues to come up with ways. I've got to find a way that I can discount and disregard the resurrection of Christ. And even just a few centuries after this idea started, that Jesus wasn't resurrected physically. It was only a spiritual resurrection. And by the way, the Jehovah's Witnesses to this day still hang on to this. It wasn't a physical resurrection. It was a spiritual resurrection. In fact, when Jesus first appears to the disciples in Luke chapter 4, it says he walked through the door. They didn't quite know what to do with that. I don't imagine any of us would. And they said, it's a ghost. They didn't know what to do. They didn't know how to react. And Jesus said, don't call me a ghost. A spirit doesn't have flesh and bones as you see that I have. And then he took a piece of fish and he ate it in front of them. His body was different for sure. He passed through that door. It was that resurrected body that Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15 that every believer will get at the end time. That glorified, incorruptible resurrection body. Very much like this one, but in some ways not at all like this one. But it was a physical body nonetheless. And by the way, that stone wasn't rolled away for him to come out. He could walk through the door. He did it twice, by the way. He appeared in that room and the door was locked. He could walk through the door. He certainly could walk through the stone slab that was there on the tomb. The stone wasn't rolled away so Jesus could come out. It was rolled away so the world could see him. There's no conspiracy happening here. There's no cover-up, no story. You want to see the evidence? God said, I'll push the stone away. Come in and look for yourself. Look at the place where the body was. He is not here. The stone was rolled away for us, not for him, that the world could come and see. And the angel testifies, listen, there is no body here. A spiritual resurrection only would leave a body in the tomb, wouldn't it? He points to the slab. It's empty. He's gone. And he says one other thing. He has risen. He's not here. That's the only plausible explanation that answers every question, that deals with every objection. That's the only plausible explanation for what happened, for why that tomb was empty. He is risen. He is not here. So we have the testimony of the empty tomb and the testimony of the angels. We also have the testimony of the eyewitnesses. I love a good courtroom drama. Legal shows and legal movies. My favorite author, my favorite fiction author is John Grisham. I've read everything, every book he's written. I love that courtroom drama, you know, the tenseness between the attorneys and the judge and the jury. I love that stuff. And even to today, one of my favorite movies is A Few Good Men. Remember that movie from the 90s? A very young Tom Cruise, a younger Jack Nicholson, looking all dapper in his Marine class A's. He slams that table. You can't handle the truth. I love that movie. That genre of story, those courtroom dramas. And in the courtroom, eyewitness testimony is everything, right? Eyewitness testimony is the most powerful testimony. Nobody else in that courtroom, not the judge, not the attorneys, not the jury, not the reporters, nobody else in that courtroom can say definitively what that eyewitness saw. Their testimony is the most powerful as they try to determine in that courtroom what is true, what really happened. All the disciples testify that they saw him after the resurrection, every one of them. Now again, let me just remind you, they were not expecting to see him. It was quite unexpected that he should show up. They were not hallucinating because they wanted so badly to see Jesus resurrected. They did not even think about it. Didn't even cross their mind. Yet all of them reported, all of them testified they saw him. Luke 24 tells us that as two of them were walking on the road to Emmaus, they saw the resurrected Jesus. Up there in the upper room, he appears to the rest of them twice. The angel says, go ahead to Galilee. Eventually they go there. I'm not sure why they waited, but eventually they get there. Matthew 28, John 21, both say they saw him in Galilee again when they got there. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, there were 500 eyewitnesses that saw him at the same time. And in Acts chapter 1, it says he spent 40 days with them, teaching them, interacting with them, intimate fellowship with them. There could have been initially a chance that you said, well, you know, maybe it was a case of mistaken identity. You saw somebody who looked like Jesus, but they spent a month and a half with the guy. Intimate fellowship with him every day. It's impossible to think after a month and a half they wouldn't have figured out, I think we got the wrong guy. Any prosecuting attorney in any one of those Grisham books would love to have three or four good, solid eyewitnesses they could put on the stand. That would make their case. That would make their day. Imagine the slam dunk of their case if they could parade over 500 witnesses into the courtroom, put them all on the stand one at a time. I saw that thing happen. No question as to what happened. No question as to the truth of that event. We have the testimony of the eyewitnesses. You say, well, that's good, Pastor. It's all convincing. That's compelling evidence that the resurrection did really happen. Okay, fair enough. But what difference does it make? I mean, why does that matter? Is this the attitude, as John Piper suggests, that belief in his resurrection is kind of like today belief in aliens? It's okay, it's all fine and well. Even if I accept that's true, what bearing does that have on me? How does that affect my life, even if it is true? What's significant about the resurrection of Jesus? In our last few moments, let me ask you to turn with me to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 4. You're in the book of Luke. Start turning to the right. John, Acts, Romans. You're in the book of Mark. I'm sorry. Luke, John, Acts, Romans. Four books over. Romans chapter 4. What is significant about the resurrection? Look at start at verse 25 of Romans chapter 4. He said, he who was delivered over because of our transgressions, he's talking about Jesus, was raised because of our justification. What Paul does there is he links the crucifixion and the resurrection together. Those two things cannot be separated. Those two things are inseparable. The resurrection is not just another feature of the salvation story. The resurrection is the main event. It's not a postscript. Jesus came. He lived a sinless life. He died on the cross for the sins of the world. Oh yeah, no, by the way, he was resurrected. It's not a postscript to the gospel. Without the resurrection, the cross is powerless. The cross is meaningless without the resurrection. Paul said this in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 17. If Christ hasn't been raised, your faith is worthless. You've trusted in a man who was not who you thought he was. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. And that's true simply because of this. A dead Savior is no Savior at all. A dead Savior can provide nothing for you and me. A dead man cannot give us life. He doesn't have it. A dead Savior is no Savior at all. Without the resurrection, we're left to wonder, what was the death of Jesus on the cross all about? What happened there? Why did that have to take place? Some would say it was an example. An example of what? Something that so very few people will actually go through? It's almost worthless to you and me. We're left to wonder, what was the crucifixion all about? Did it accomplish anything? Was God satisfied with that? Was it enough? And Paul says here in Romans 4, 25, he said he was crucified for our transgressions, bore our transgressions on the cross. He was crucified. And God was satisfied with it. How do we know that? By the other half of that verse. He was raised because of our justification. The resurrection is the means by which God has taken that forgiveness that Christ purchased on the cross and applies it to us. He was raised because of our justification, for our justification. That means that when God looks at someone who has repented of their sins and trusted in Christ, He doesn't see the wickedness anymore. He doesn't see our sinful past. He doesn't see us as our sinful self. He sees the righteousness of Christ credited to our account. That's what it means to be justified. We didn't earn that. He gave that. And look down at verse 1 of chapter 5. Chapter 4, verse 25 says that, listen, forgiveness, total and complete forgiveness, that's why the resurrection matters. Chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Why does the resurrection matter? Because of that, we have peace with God. We're no longer enemies. No longer separated. The forgiveness of our sins means that we can have peace with God. No longer enemies of His. We're at peace with Him now because of the resurrection. In verse 2 of chapter 5, he goes on. As they would say on TV, but that's not all. Through whom we also have obtained our introduction by faith into this grace in which we stand. What does the resurrection matter? It matters because faith in the resurrection brings us into a life of God's grace. Paul would say over in Romans chapter 10, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart, what? That God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. The grace of God applied to our lives. But not just at that moment. Notice how Paul said it there in chapter 5. In this grace we stand every moment of every day. We stand in an environment of God's grace. Why? Because of the resurrection. And he says down in the last part of that verse, and we exult in hope. Why does the resurrection matter? It brings us hope. Hope that this life is not all there is. There is more to it. Down in verse 5, he said, this hope does not disappoint. There are a lot of things in this world that we hope in, right? And a lot of them are going to disappoint. I might hope in my job, eventually that's going to disappoint. I might hope in my friends or in my family, but eventually that's going to disappoint. This hope does not disappoint. Do we have credible evidence that the resurrection of Jesus is real? Without a doubt. The evidence for the resurrection is powerful that it occurred. And what does it matter? Well, that does depend on you. Do you want that forgiveness? That complete and total forgiveness? Do you want to know that every sin you have committed, every sin you might commit today, every sin you would commit in the future, do you want to know they all have been forgiven? Then the resurrection matters. Do you want God to look at you? And do you want Him to see you as a sinner, deserving of His wrath? Or do you want Him to see you in righteousness, the righteousness of Christ? Then the resurrection matters. Do you want peace with God? To know without a doubt that if my heart stopped today, I would spend eternity in heaven with Him. Do you want peace with God? Then the resurrection matters. Do you want grace? Do you want hope? Then the resurrection matters. In a few moments, we're going to gather around the table of communion, take communion together. So that's a little bit odd. Why would we take communion on Easter Sunday? This communion celebrates the crucifixion, it remembers the crucifixion of Christ. But as we just talked about, those two things cannot be separated. We cannot have one without the other. We're going to celebrate the crucifixion and the resurrection of Christ, the power of the crucifixion right here in the resurrection. In our church, we practice what is called open communion. And that means that if you are a baptized believer in Christ, then we certainly invite you to join us in partaking of the Lord's Supper. Also, though, if you are from another denomination, and you would be offered communion in that church, in that denomination, then we invite you to take communion with us. But Paul says over in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, he said, listen, this is a serious event. This is a serious occasion when we come around the Lord's table, and we shouldn't take that lightly. If you're here this morning, you don't know that any of those things, why the resurrection matters, the forgiveness of God, the peace with God, the grace of God, the hope, if you don't know that that's real in your life, I don't know that I have a relationship with Christ. If I died right now, I don't know where I'd spend eternity. If that's you this morning, Paul said a man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. If you don't know you have a relationship with Christ, just quietly let those plates pass. And parents, I would ask you just to, you make that, you know your children better than anyone else. If you know they have a relationship with Christ, that's up to you to determine whether they can take the Lord's Supper. I would ask the guys that would help me to serve to come on up. This is a time of memorial for us, a time of celebration of what Christ has done for us, his crucifixion on the cross and his resurrection that gives that power. Paul said this in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. He said, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. Father, we thank you for the bread, the symbolism of your broken body on that cross. Lord, we know that that broken body that was laid in that tomb didn't stay dead, didn't stay in that tomb. We thank you that you hung on that cross, the shame of the cross, the terror of the cross, the torture of the cross. You hung there willingly and said, Father, forgive them. Lord, thank you. As we remember your broken body this morning, in Jesus' name.